All right, let's take a look at number 10. That's 4x over 7 minus x less than x. All right. Remember we went on the right-hand side here? We want a 0 over here, don't we? So we have to get rid of this x. So we get rid of that x by subtracting an x. So we subtract an x from this side. We have to subtract an x from this side. Scooch that over a little bit. Give me some room. So we subtract an x from here, and we subtract an x from here. So I'm going to put it over 1 because I'm subtracting it from another fraction. And that's going to go to 0. So see what we're going to do over here on the left-hand side. Well, when we're adding or subtracting fractions, we're going to find a common denominator. Common denominator is just 7 minus x, because that's a 1, which is our common denominator, less than x minus x is 0. So I got a 0 over here. That was my goal at first, okay, before I do anything else, is to get that 0 on the right-hand side. But now what I have to do is I got to simplify this side over here. All right. So what do we do to 7 minus x to get to 7 minus x? We didn't do anything, did we? So we don't do anything to the 4x, so we just keep, actually, sorry. So there, we just basically multiply by 1, technically. And so we do that to the top, 4x. Right? Minus. Now, what did you do to this 1 in order to get to this denominator? You multiplied it by what? 7 minus x, right? You multiplied by the whole entire thing, didn't you? So, what does that mean you have to do up here? Multiply that by the whole entire thing. Okay? Now, you notice something, don't you? Now, notice what I did here. I put that parentheses there. You had to know to do that, okay? You didn't see a parentheses down here, but you had to know to put a parentheses here. And the reason why you needed a parentheses here is because you have to distribute this through that whole entire thing. That's where a lot of people, and I've said this before, but a lot of people throughout my years of teaching this kind of stuff tend to forget to put parentheses here and tend to forget to distribute. Another thing, there's two things about this that a lot of students forget to do. They forget to put parentheses around it, so they don't distribute. They just multiply like the first two together, and that's it. But a second thing would be the negative. Okay, if they have a negative right there, a lot of people tend to forget to distribute the negative as well. Right, so you got to be careful of that. Be mindful of that. So let's see what we're going to get. We can do that distributing right here in our head, can't we? So it's negative x times 7, and it's negative x times negative x. So what is negative x times 7? It's just negative 7x. But here's the part. Most people get that part right, okay? That's usually not a problem. It's the second part that a lot of people mess up on. It's negative x times negative x, which is what? Positive x squared. Okay? All right. So now let's see what we get. I don't know. Yeah, we can add some like terms here, can't we? Add those two together. So let's put the x squared. Since it's an x squared, I always like to put that first. And then we'll subtract these. 4x minus 7x is minus 3x. And then on the bottom is 7 minus x. Still less than 0. All right, so now we've accomplished what we wanted at first anyway, right? We wanted to get a 0 on the right-hand side, and we just wanted to simplify the left-hand side as much as we could, right? To get one denominator, or one numerator and one denominator. We didn't want this minus x thing here. We wanted just one solid numerator, and then one solid denominator. Keep on mixing up my words. So now, once we get that situation, what are we going to do to both of these things? What are we going to do to the numerator? We're going to take that numerator and do what to it? Good. Set it equal to 0, right? And then we're going to do the same thing with the denominator. So we just come over here, put the denominator equal to 0 as well. Everybody with me so far? All right. So all we've done so far is just setting stuff up. We haven't even, you know, solved for anything yet. But now we're getting there. Okay, that's what we're starting to do now. So what we have to do is we've got to solve for x right here. And what's the best way to do this? Well, you see common factor, don't you? Greatest common factor. We did one very similar to this yesterday, I believe. So we factor out an x, and what's left over? X minus 3. So that's the first thing I want to do. I don't want to add an x to both sides. I don't want to get x on both sides, do I? I always want to get x on the same side, and it's already on the same side. But now I just have to get x by itself. It's about the only way we can do it. Now, if you take a look at these, both of these things are being multiplied together, and your answer is 0. So what are we going to do with both of those things. We're going to set them both equal to 0. So we're going to set x equal to 0, and then we're going to take the thing that's being multiplied, x minus 3, and set that equal to 0. We can just do this math real quick. X minus 3 equals 0, so x equals 3. Now, I'm not circling these, because circling it means that's my final answer, right? Put in a little box so I remember it, because we're going to come back to this in just a couple seconds, right? Come over here, do the same thing, solve for x. Add an x to both sides, so x equals 7. Put that in a little box. Now you don't have to put it in a box. I'm just doing it just for teaching purposes. All right? What are we going to do with those three numbers right there? Put it where? On a number line. Very good. All right, so let's do that. Here's my number line. Let's put those three numbers on here. Put them in chronological order, okay? Like, it's on a number line, right? It's got to go in order. So what's my smallest number here? 0. And then the next one would be 3. And the next one would be 7. Now, this is very helpful to me because now how many different areas or sections do I have here? I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 different sections. Agreed? Now, if you want to go through this really quick, I think it probably will work. All right? We talked about this yesterday a little bit as far as, you know, will it always work? I think every time that I give you a problem, this will probably always work. And what am I talking about anyway? Find out which section comes out to be positive, which one is negative. And let's chuck this. Let's copy that and put it down here so I can see it with my graph. So I don't have to keep... Oh, no. I hate doing that. Let's try that again. There we go. Grab it. There we go. All right, so this is what we're putting some numbers into, right? And what are we looking for? We're looking to find out what makes this thing less than 0, or what makes this thing what? What number is less than 0? It's a negative number, right? So we want to find out what values on this number line right here make this thing on the left-hand side less than 0 or negative. Okay, what values make this thing right here negative? So let's just plug some numbers in and see which ones work. Right? Now, I've got numbers to the left of 0, in between 0 and 3, in between 3 and 7, and to the right of 7. So what do you think, I don't know, to me, what do you think the easiest number on this number line would be to throw into this little inequality right here? Now, we're not going to use 0 because 0 is one of my numbers here, isn't it? All right. But I want to pick a number either here, 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 or here. What do you think the easiest number would be? What? Say what? You could pick negative 1. What would be easier than that? Yeah, pick a 1, right? 1 lies in between here somewhere, doesn't it? Okay, so let's pick a 1. Now, you don't have to. You could pick negative 1. You're not wrong. I'm not saying you're wrong. I just think, personally, I think the easiest number to pick would be a positive 1. So let's put a positive 1 in for this and see what kind of answer we get. Do we get a positive answer or a negative answer? So let's stick a 1 in here. 1 squared is 1 minus 3 times 1, which is 3. Now, what's that going to give you? What kind of sign is that going to give you, 1 minus 3? It's going to give you a negative sign, isn't it? Now, I don't really care about the number itself. I just care about what the sign's going to be. What about the bottom? Let's stick a 1 in for that. 7 minus 1. 7 minus 1 is 6. That's positive, so that's a positive. So if I pick any number, I picked a 1, which is between 0 and 3. I could pick any number between 0 and 3. All right? Some people say, well, there's only two numbers in between there. Well, there's a lot more than that, isn't there? I mean, there's a 1 and a 2. Those are your whole numbers, but there's also fractions and decimals inside of there, isn't there? All right? So I could pick any number I wanted. Now, that'd be kind of silly to pick some fraction or decimal, but any number that I choose between 0 and 3 is always going to give me a negative answer. So this little section right here will always come out negative. Now, watch. If that comes out negative, what do you think right next door is going to be? This is probably going to be positive, and what's this going to be? Positive. What's this going to be? Negative. All right, because it jumps, right? So it goes positive, negative. All right? We just had to figure out which one was which, right? So if you do one, you should be able to figure out what the other ones are going to be. It saves a little time. But just for fun, we got some time, right? Just for fun, let's stick another number in just to make sure, okay? If you're doubting yourself whether that's actually positive or not, let's just make sure. So, let's get rid of this. I have a little bit of room. Let's do the same thing as we did over here, but let's pick a negative 1 this time and throw it into this. Let's see what we get. So if I take a negative 1 and square it, what do I get? I get a positive 1, don't I? Negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. Minus 3 times negative 1. So it's minus what? Negative 3, isn't it? All right, so you got to be careful with that. 1 minus negative 3 is positive 4, so we get a positive. So the top becomes positive. What about the bottom? What if I stick a negative 1 in for this? 7 minus negative 1, that's plus, so that's a positive as well, isn't it? What's a positive over a positive? It's positive. So it does work, doesn't it? All right, so I feel a little bit better about it, don't you? Checking that. And if you wanted to check numbers in between here and here, you can. Now, again, you can pick any number. These aren't like magical numbers. You know, it's not like I always have to pick one. I just picked any number between 0 and 3. And to me, 1 was the easiest one. Don't you agree? Now, what does that mean for our answer? What are we trying to find? We're trying to find all the values that are negative, less than 0, right? So where are all the values? Here and here. How do I write that? I'll tell you what, let's graph it first, and then we'll write it in interval notation. I know it doesn't ask you to graph these, but I think it's very helpful. It's less than, it's not or equal to, so what kind of, are we going to have open, closed, what are we going to have here? It's going to be all open, isn't it? Because it just says less than, there's no or equal to. So where are they negative? Well, between 0 and 3. So I put a parentheses here, and then I shade everything in between. Okay? And then, where else is it negative? From 7, right? Actually, not from 7. Everything greater than 7. So I put a parentheses here, and then I shade all this stuff in, put an arrow. So there's your answer right there. There's your graph. But how do I write this in interval notation? It basically looks identical to the graph, okay? Except you just get rid of all the graph stuff, right? So you go 0, comma 3. It's open on both ends. Put a union in between. And what is this? This is a parentheses. It's open at 7, and it goes all the way to where? This keeps on going to the right, goes to positive infinity. And it's always open at infinity. And that would be your answer. We will circle that one, okay, because that's your answer right there. Does that help a little bit? All right. I don't think it'll get a whole lot harder than that one right there, I'll tell you the truth. It's about as tough as it gets. Are you understanding, like, which one's positive, which one's negative? Okay, let me know if any of this is not, you know, clicking with you. All right. That was, what was that one, 10? Okay, let's do 11. Is that any? Yeah, it's pretty much the same exact problem, isn't it? Tell you what, I'll let you just work on 11, okay, if you didn't get it. Because you saw how we did 10. 11's almost identical to it. Just the numbers are just a little bit different. So I'll let you do that one. Let's do, like, either 8 or 9. Let's do 9, because yesterday we did one where we had a constant in the denominator, didn't we? We didn't have it in the numerator, so let's try number 9. That looks a little bit different. So let's write this down. It's negative 7 over negative 6x minus 3, and that is greater than 0. All right, well, you already got a 0 on the right-hand side, so that saves you some steps. That's kind of nice compared to the problem we just finished doing. So what are we going to do here? We're going to set everything equal to 0, right? Set the numerator equal to 0. But can you set negative 7 equal to 0? No, because negative 7 equals negative 7. Negative 7 can't equal 0, right? So basically, I don't even worry about the numerator. Everybody see that? So if I have a constant here, I don't even set that equal to 0 because there's no way negative 7 can equal 0. So I don't even worry about the numerator. The only thing I have a variable in is the denominator. So let's take the denominator and just set that equal to 0. Right.
Are you allowed to have a zero in the denominator?
No.
Okay, just right. Checking.
But it's not. It doesn't say or equal, does it? So what we're going to do, we're using that just to kind of divide our number line up, right, and check numbers to the left of whatever number we're going to get and to the right, okay? And you're absolutely right. This cannot equal zero, but this isn't really going to be one of our solutions. This is just going to set it up so we break it into our sections, right? And then you can have numbers that are greater than or less than zero. Just can't have it to equal to zero. So let's do this. Let's solve for x. Add a 3 to both sides. Just do it. And then divide by negative 6, all right? And that's what? Negative a half, right? So x equals negative 1/2. Now, this is not a solution to this, is it? Because if I put negative 1/2 in for this, the denominator is equal to 0, and then it's undefined. So negative 1/2 is not going to be part of our solution. But it's going to divide our number line up into, less than negative 1 half and greater than negative 1 half. So we'll put the negative 1 half right here. So negative 1 half is not going to work, all right? Because if I stick a negative 1 half in here, my answer is going to be undefined. But that's okay, because that's not going to be part of my solution in the end anyway, right? Because I'm going to put a bracket or a parentheses around it. It's going to be open, which means it cannot include negative 1 half. So let's pick some numbers either to the left or to the right. What do you think the easiest number to choose would possibly be in this case? Look, pick numbers either to the left of negative 1 half or to the right of negative 1 half.
1 and 0?
I think 0 would be the easiest number to pick, wouldn't it? All right, so where does 0 lie? Is it to the left or is it to the right?
To the right.
It's to the right. So 0 is over here somewhere, isn't it? That's probably the easiest number to choose, so let's put a 0 in for this. All right, so we're going back to this thing right here, and we're putting a 0 in for it. Of course, you can't put a 0 in for negative 7. So what is the sign of the top of this? It's negative, isn't it? Now, we stick a 0 in for this, and let's figure out what the sign of the bottom is going to be. So it's negative 6 times 0, which is 0, minus 3, which is?
Negative 3.
No? Oh, yeah, it is. What am I thinking? I was thinking something. I was thinking a step ahead, negative divided by negative. But you're absolutely right. It's a negative, isn't it? I was thinking negative or negative is positive. All right, so you got a negative on the top. If I stick in a 0, or really any number to the right of negative 1 half, I'm going to get a negative on the bottom. I mean, you can pick one. Pick 1, pick 10, pick 100 if you want to. It doesn't matter. You're going to get a negative on the bottom, okay? So what's negative divided by negative? Well, that's a positive. So that means everything to the right is positive, and everything where? To the left is negative, okay? So what's my answer then? I want to find all the numbers that are what? Greater than 0, which means what? Positive. So how am I going to graph that? I'm going to put a parenthesis here and shade everything to the right. So that's what my graph's going to look like. Now my interval notation is just as easy to write. It's open here, and where is it? It's negative 1 half, right? Because I'm at negative 1 half, comma, where? Infinity. All right, and that would be your answer right there. Does that make sense a little bit? It was a little easier math-wise, wasn't it? But sometimes it's a little bit weird knowing the signs, because you got a constant up here, and they don't always give you a constant, and this time they do. So it was just a negative 7. Negative 7 is always going to be negative 7. Would you agree? So it doesn't change depending on what x is. Negative 7 is just negative 7. So that's always going to be negative. Now, this one does change depending on what kind of number you put in for it. So we put in a 0, which is everything to the right of negative 1 half. You stick any number that's greater than negative 1 half, it's going to make that a negative. So negative over negative is positive. Everything here is positive. And that's what we're looking for, isn't it? That's all there is to it. All right. This stuff seemed pretty crazy when we first went over it, didn't it? With this number line stuff and all the brackets and parentheses and infinities and negative infinities and all that. But now, hopefully, after we've done this for a little while now, it's starting to make a little bit more sense. Do you feel that at all?
Yeah.
Okay, I need some feedback here. Okay. All right. I don't know. Maybe some of you saw it right away. It was no big deal when I first taught it, and it's still no big deal. Maybe some of you were lost when I first taught it, and maybe you're still lost. Let me know. If that's your situation, all right, if you're still lost on this, you got to come to me, and you got to ask for some extra help, all right, because I can only do so much in class. You got to do your part and ask for extra help if you need it. All right? This is on YouTube, so if you need to go back and look at it. So we're going to have a quiz, and the quiz tomorrow is going to look very, very similar to this lesson. All right? I'll let you hang on to this so you can look over it to review. But bring it tomorrow. Don't leave it in your locker or anything. Bring it tomorrow, and I'll collect it right before we take the quiz. Is that all right? But use it, okay? The reason I let you hang on to it is so you can actually use it to practice a little more. So maybe you got a couple wrong that we didn't go over today in class. It's your responsibility to go through that. Like number 11? Right. Somebody asked about number 11. We didn't do it, but it's very, very close to number 10. So if you follow how to do number 10, you should be able to get number 11. So work on that on your own. I'll collect that tomorrow.